Bingo, we're back, 5 o'clock rock. You know, we live in interesting times these days, and it's wonderful to have a Court of Appeals judge, Judge Rick Clifton from the Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals on our show with us. Welcome to the show.
It's good to be here.
You know, we were talking before about so many things in the world have changed, and you've been sitting since, what, 1992 on the Court of Appeals?
Court of Appeals since 2002, so this is my 15th year.
Yeah, it could be more.
Seems like forever, but...
And you have a heavy workload. You sit and listen to many, many arguments. And I wonder if you could spend a few minutes and just tell us what it's like to be a judge on the Court of Appeals.
It's very engaging in terms of the intellectual challenge, realizing that we're being asked to make decisions that have a real-life impact on a good number of people. Does somebody stay in jail? Does somebody get deported? There are a fair number of cases that might be described as routine, but it's never routine to the people involved. And there are always enough cases each month that are challenging, are engaging. We're asked to answer hard questions and to do it not simply in a hypothetical or academic context, but in a way that affects people's lives. Mm-hmm. So the intellectual stimulation is enormous. And my wife observed that when I left private practice for the court, I wound up working substantially longer hours than I did when I was in private practice, being paid more handsomely by the hour for my services. But the engagement and the energy that comes out of the things that we work on is such that that's simply what we have to do.
Judge Clifton worked for the law firm of Cade Shuddy Fleming Wright for quite a while. He was a partner there. Handling business matters, I guess, primarily.
Mostly commercial civil litigation.
Mm-hmm. And then he was appointed by President Bush to the Court of Appeals in, what, 2002?
2002. I was nominated in 2001, and there was no opposition. Ultimately, it was confirmed 98-0, but the process just stretched out, as these processes tend to do, so it wound up being about a year and a half from beginning to end until I was finally seated on the court.
And the Senate Judiciary Committee liked Judge Clifton because he knew a lot about the Chicago Cubs. Am I right?
You're right. It was odd that I was tipped off. Mine was an uneventful hearing. Most of the senators didn't come, and the people in the Justice Department said that's a good thing. And after the first couple fairly standard questions, Senator Spector, then from Pennsylvania, a Republican at the time, had heard from somebody else in Congress who knew me from before that I was a fan of the Chicago Cubs. And so he started posing questions about baseball. Senator Leahy was then the chairman of the committee. He was there. Senator Spector's a Phillies fan. Senator Leahy, a Red Sox fan. And the only other senator who was there, Senator Maria Cantwell from the state of Washington, probably not a baseball fan from her reactions, seemed bewildered as to what was going on. But I took it to be a good sign they were more interested in my baseball feelings than anything else. So.
And you haven't changed your view of the Chicago Cubs?
Well, not at all. And of course, as everybody must know by now, if only because they're glad that they don't have to keep hearing about 1908, the Chicago Cubs are the World Series champions. First time in my lifetime they were even in the World Series.
I can't say that you learned that here on ThinkTech.
You probably heard it before.
Well, so, you know, but things have changed. And, you know, we're in a different administration, or at least as of January 20th. The way people deal with each other, the way the First Amendment is handled, the way our society in these 50 states, you know, has changed. And I imagine since 2002, it's changed from your point of view as well. How do you see the country evolving, if I can ask?
Well, the country, President Obama said a couple weeks ago, it's not a straight line, fits and starts. And sometimes the jumps are a little further. It's not at all unusual to go back and forth. If you look at political history, going back and forth between parties every 8 years is pretty common. And even many of those who speculated that Secretary Clinton would win the presidential election this year would observe that the Republicans probably had a good chance of winning if they'd nominated a more traditional Republican. Of course, few people saw what was going to come, but that wouldn't have been unusual. If you go back, President Clinton was in office for 8 years. The second Bush was in office for 8 years. President Obama in office for 8 years. A little bit of an aberration before, when the first President Bush followed President Reagan, so it was 12 years, but before that, that was a Democrat. And the parties in a two-party system will ordinarily gravitate toward a form of equipoise. And that doesn't mean every state. Indeed, most states aren't battleground states. But the nation as a whole, it's not unusual. And what we should be grateful for, and we just take this for granted, but I had one of my colleagues once comment that she was asked by a judge from Russia what would happen when the president who nominated her was no longer in office, the assumption being she'd be swept from office too. And that's not how the federal courts, or generally courts, work in this country. We should be grateful for it. So my work really doesn't change very much. Mm-hmm. The identity of people nominated to join the court will change over time, and that has an impact. But the work itself, and even that's not a dramatic impact. Positions are filled as vacancies open, but it doesn't turn around overnight.
Well, just 2 weeks ago, maybe three, you were on a panel for the Federalist Society. It was organized by Carl Smith Ball, and it was in the Hawaiian Electric Auditorium there at Bishop Square. It was a really interesting program. Kenji Price organized it from Carl Smith Ball, and you were there with Judge Burns and Brad Glosserman of Pacific Forum. I was very impressed. We took film of that, and we've actually played it on OC16 of you and the others. And what interested me was the notion that things are changing globally, and we have countries, coming of age in terms of judicial precedent, and sometimes that precedent is of interest to American judges and American courts, particularly when interpreting the United States Constitution. Can you summarize your thoughts in that regard and the contribution that you made in the panel that day?
Well, the debate in the past, I'd say two decades, has evolved from the doctrine of originalism, most prominently identified with Justice Scalia, who passed away earlier this year, whose view was that the Constitution should be interpreted based on its meaning at the time of its adoption, 1789, the Bill of Rights, within the first few years after that. That was actually a departure among conservative thinkers such as Judge Bork, who was more interested perhaps in trying to divine the intent or purpose of the founders. And Justice Scalia refined that to say, well, it's not necessarily the people that were in the room, although we pay attention to that and talk about the intent of the founders, but also the population generally who had to vote to ratify the Constitution. So he was interested in what do those terms mean at that time? And the opposing school of thought, although they're not direct opposites, is the so-called living Constitution, mm-hmm. about which Justice Breyer has been most prolific in writing outside judicial decisions the last few years. The notion being that the Constitution was deliberately written with some concepts that would evolve over time. The most commonly cited example, what's the meaning of cruel and unusual punishment, specifically prohibited in the application of cruel and unusual punishment is specifically prohibited by the Eighth Amendment. And cruel and unusual means something today in the mind of Justice Breyer than it meant in 1791 when the amendment was adopted and ratified. And that's the long-standing debate. And so the question of whether U.S. Supreme Court decisions or lower court decisions turning on interpretation of the Constitution, to what extent does a foreign judicial opinion speak to that? Justice Scalia would have said, not at all, because what a court in some other country might say, particularly if it's after 1790, doesn't speak to what that term was understood to mean in the United States at that time. Whereas a believer in the living Constitution would refer to decisions from other countries as a reflection of how human rights have come to mean something different over time. But it comes up in other contexts too. I was surprised to encounter after the panel that you referred to last week in connection with one of the cases I was hearing in San Francisco, It was an application of the Miranda warnings, which we all know from watching TV. You have a right to remain silent. Anything you say can and will be used against you in a court of law and so forth. And in the course of working on that case, I went back and read the Miranda decision again, which came out in 66, 50 mm-hmm. years ago this year. Mm-hmm. And it turns out that the Miranda decision itself looked to some foreign law sources and experience with regard to police interrogation techniques. So the question and the citation to foreign law authorities isn't a new one. It's taken on a new controversy of late. And even Justice Scalia cited to law sources from outside the United States in appropriate context. For example, I won't get into the details, but there's a legal doctrine that whether a new rule of criminal procedure is fundamental, does saying that somebody has this right really affect the accuracy or reliability of a verdict that might have been rendered against him before? And one particular case had to do with whether a certain decision should be made by a jury or by a judge. The Constitution gives us the right to jury trial in most cases. But some decisions in the past had been made by judges, and in particular, in this case, it had to do with application of the death penalty. Sentences are traditionally imposed by judges, but the Supreme Court has said if states have the death penalty, that's a question that has to be put to the jury. So the Supreme Court was faced with a question, well, was that retroactive? Was that so fundamental that we wouldn't recognize death sentences imposed by judges previously? And Justice Scalia observed that, you know, most nations, even in the Western legal tradition, don't have juries to begin with. So the absence of a jury can't be so fundamental that we think the decision would be unreliable. Now, in that opinion, he went on to say it's not appropriate to turn to foreign law sources to interpret our Constitution, but in this case he was looking at it to decide was it fundamental and decided it wasn't. So even he would cite foreign law sources in some contexts.
And it's really interesting how you can interpret. It's not absolute. It's never absolute, even when you're treating the implications.
Not many black and white. I mean, it's shades of gray in our world.
Shades of gray in our world. And one of the interesting things, well, Judge Burns had an interesting remark after your remarks, the principal remarks at the beginning of the program. He said, well, if it comes from, if it's a reasonable idea, I'll take it. I was a little troubled by that because we're talking about precedent here. Don't you have to have at least some hook in precedent before you can accept an idea as reasonable?
You do, but his central thesis is correct, which is judges are principally trying to get it right. Now the question is, what's the meaning of right? As much as the world has missed an opportunity, they haven't made me czar. And so it's not up to me to decide what's right in all contexts. I'm applying statutes, regulations, precedent, and so forth. Now, there's lots of gray there, so there's lots of room in between. And sometimes there's a lot of room in between. And so I have not a blank slate, but a slate without a whole lot of constraints mm-hmm. there. And in that context, if you have a good idea from someplace, it's worth paying attention to the good idea. Is it a good idea because it has been stated by the Supreme Court of Australia or whatever source? No, it's just a good idea. And for my purposes, citing to the foreign law authority is of perhaps marginal value in terms of persuasiveness, but it's, you give credit where credit is due. You don't want to plagiarize, so you recognize that, but it has to stand on its own logic and in the context of American law.
And in the context of where it comes from and the circumstances involved, some countries will be more persuasive than others, for example.
Well, practicing lawyer in Hawaii for years, when we started more years ago than I want to count, there wasn't a lot of established Hawaii law on a lot of subjects. And so we're routinely turning to the law of other states. And some states would have more clout than others. Mm-hmm. They'd just be more aggressive. And certainly that would be true for foreign nations as well.
We're going to take a short break, Judge Clifton.
Okay.
We'll be right back, and we're going to ask Judge Clifton about the comments made by Brad Glosserman at this very same panel, which were different than what the jurists were saying that day. We'll be right back.
Aloha, everybody. My name is Mark Shklov. I'd like you to join me for my program, Law Across the Sea on thinktechhawaii.com. Aloha.
Hello, I'm Marianne Sasaki. Welcome to ThinkTech Hawaii, where some of the most interesting conversations in Honolulu go on. I have a show on Wednesdays from 1 to 2 called Life in the Law, where we discuss legal issues, politics, governmental topics, and a whole host of issues. I hope you'll join me.
ThinkTech Hawaii, Asia in Review. I am Johnson Choi, the host. Looking forward to see you next month, December 15, Thursday, 11, right here at this channel. Aloha.
Hi, I'm Stacy Hayashi with the ThinkTech Hawaii show, Stacy to the Rescue, highlighting some of Hawaii's issues. You can catch it at ThinkTech Hawaii on Mondays at 11 a.m. Aloha. See you then.
Okay, we're back with Judge Richard Clifton, a Court of Appeals judge in the U.S. Court of Appeals Ninth Circuit. We are delighted to have him here to talk about things that judges think about, but no content, no substance.
Just, fair enough.
So, you know, one of the interesting parts of that program, it sort of surprised me a little. First, I couldn't figure out exactly why Brad Glosserman and Pacific Forum was on the panel. Then, when he spoke, I realized why. Talking about globalism, talking about a world that's different now than when Thomas Friedman discovered it wasn't flat. And we're talking about things that change more quickly now than ever before. We're talking about different interrelationships priorities between the nations of the world. All this is happening while you watch, increasingly so. And so he was saying, well, you know, you really have to be mindful of what other countries are doing, not only because what you can learn from them, but because it's a diplomatic issue. You want them to think, to feel that we are respectful of their laws, that we are part of the same global community. And therefore, it's good for the United States on a diplomatic basis, on a social, rather, a foreign policy basis, to be said to consider precedent from elsewhere. Your thoughts?
It doesn't have a lot to do with our day-to-day activities. Probably because there's so much American law that if there's a good idea that might come to us from Canada or Portugal or wherever else, lawyers aren't going to find it and give it to us, and we don't have the time in most cases to go look for it ourselves. Leaving aside cases that affirmatively involve foreign law, and a case last year that involved French law, so we have lots of French citations. But other than that, those are fairly rare. It's pretty unusual. Like almost never, and I'd say never, except you never say never. I don't recall a case where a foreign law authority was cited to us in a brief, except where the case specifically involved foreign law. So I understand what he says, and indeed, I'm engaged in some outreach efforts. Indirectly, I'm an officer and secretary of the Federal Judges Association, and there's a International Relations Committee that regularly attends meetings of the International Association of Judges. I'm personally involved with a good number of the Pacific states. I customarily attend the meetings every other year of something called the Pacific Judicial Conference. Over the years, I've attended meetings in Tonga, Guam, Tahiti, Solomon Islands, and so forth, where we meet with judges from Pacific nations. I have a member of a committee, the Ninth Circuit Pacific Islands Committee, that deals with the U.S. territories in the Pacific and also with the freely associated states, Palau, Marshall Islands, Federated States of Micronesia. So I have dealings with foreign judges. Does it enter into how we behave in deciding cases? The answer is basically no. Even as I understand Brad's point, that it might be useful if we're trying to encourage the rule of law. And I have lots of colleagues that are involved in education programs and going to Pakistan and Kazakhstan, and a lot of people that went to Eastern Europe after the fall of the Iron Curtain to work on rule of law programs. but it doesn't really enter into our decision-making process.
But it does raise, your comments on this raise, in, at least in my mind, the notion that even though it's a Court of Appeals judge appointed for life, it doesn't really affect your career whether or not you join all these voluntary judicial organizations. You're doing that for the common good. You're doing that for service, which we should all appreciate.
True.
But I think I hear what you say, that it's part of the job in the sense it's an obligation of the judge to expose himself, to go out and belong to these committees, to work on these projects, to carry the message, learn and also speak about important public issues.
Different judges have different attitudes. I'm not going to say somebody else is wrong. From my perspective, we are public servants, and the legitimacy of the courts depends on public support, and it's important for people to understand what courts do. So many of us try to be engaged in public outreach, civic initiatives, public education. My own case, I years ago taught part-time at the UH Law School, and I picked it up again. Hard to fit in with my schedule, so after actually teaching a few seminars, I pulled back again, but try to participate in other ways at the law school. Still am a dues-paying member of the Hawaii State Bar Association, though I don't have to be. But I am, and I regularly attend, when I'm in town, meetings of its appellate section, and was at the State Bar Convention last month, speaking on a panel. And it's, say, other things. I think it's important and useful for the courts, and frankly, I like getting engaged with people, because one of the downsides of this job is it can be pretty isolated.
From a political point of view, judges customarily are—they're taken from given states in the Court of Appeals, and that's because they understand that state, and they bring that special knowledge and affinity to the court. I think is a benefit to the court and to the state when that happens. And I've noticed that you have stayed in touch. Your office is down the block. You are here. You are involved in activities. You are following many things that happen in this community, although you don't have to, and you could live in San Francisco just as easily in the Ninth Circuit.
It's cold there.
Okay, now we have our answer.
Now you have the truth. But I guess San Diego's not so cold. So. No, I this is where I want to live, and I wasn't raised here. I came here to be a law clerk to my predecessor, Herbert Choi, and at the end of that year realized this is where I wanted to spend more time, and ultimately, that was more than 40 years ago. This is where my kids were born and raised. This is where our home is and where we spend most of the time. The nature of what I do means I'm gone a lot, but I don't want to be so completely detached, so I read the Star Advertiser every day. When I'm gone, it may be on an iPad. I'm old enough otherwise to read it in paper, but and try to stay as engaged as I can, even as I know that the reality is that my focus is mostly elsewhere, but this is where I want to live.
Yeah. Well, from my point of view and our point of view, I think in the Bar Association locally, I think we appreciate that. We appreciate that you could just stay in a closed room, hear arguments, write decisions. Opinions, and that would be done with it there. But you choose to stay in touch, and I think that's important to everyone involved that you do that. And I actually think that every Court of Appeals judge ought to do that. Although I know that it's no requirement.
It's probably more important here. I'm the only one. That's just the reality of it. And I am taking senior status at the end of this year, and that seat will be filled by somebody from Hawaii. I don't have to let it go. I continue to work as much as I want, and so. From my perspective, one of the reasons for taking senior status pretty promptly upon being eligible is to give somebody else from Hawaii a chance. And when there is somebody else here, I know Judge Choi took a half step back from public engagement after he took senior status, only he wasn't replaced by somebody from Hawaii. In those days, the assignment of, it's still not formal, but the assignment of seats to states wasn't as well defined as it is today. Now it's, well, now there is a statute that actually will assure there's a replacement for my position. Technically, they could fill another seat, but there will be somebody appointed from the state of Hawaii to fill the seat. if you're one of the dozen judges who are from the Los Angeles area, it may be less important for each of them to be engaged with the community. If you're the only game in town, as I am, or we have judges from Idaho and Montana and the other smaller states in the same situation that I am, then it's that much more important to be engaged.
What does it mean to be on senior status? Does it mean that you kick back and you know, watch the Chicago Cubs, if I may?
Well, I do that even when I'm active status. But yeah, what it means is that on that date, I am eligible to retire, and I could stop working completely, and it wouldn't affect. I mean, it's an oddity, perhaps, but we're appointed for life, so. I passed my eligibility date actually last week. I could quit completely, not do another day's worth of work for the court, and I'd continue to get paid as an annuity, the same thing I'm getting paid as a judge. But the kind of people that get appointed to these jobs are sufficiently compulsive or aren't financially astute or whatever. We all pretty much just keep working. In my case, I'll shift my attention a little bit. I've been involved the last year and will continue for the next couple of years in some internal court governance matters that take a lot of time, and I will probably cut back the number of cases I hear over the next year or two to make up for that. But I'm still mostly going to be doing the same thing that I'm doing now.
Yeah.
I will try to make my way to spring training to see the Cubs and so forth, but I did that even as an active judge, so that won't change very much either. So it's basically the same gig, only I'm not being paid any more for it.
Been a great career, you know, for you. It's wonderful.
It's extraordinarily fortunate. There are 100 lawyers in Hawaii that are qualified for this job, and I feel fortunate that things worked out so that I got it. It's some people describe it as being struck by lightning in terms of the odds, and the threat of being killed by it is there too. But if you don't get killed by it, then you've
it makes you stronger.
It makes you stronger. It does.
Speaking of strength, one last final question.
Sure.
You know, this campaign over the past couple of years has been disruptive, and you know, there's a sign on the New York City Supreme Court courthouse that says something about public confidence is the firmest pillar of the administration of justice, or along those lines. And public confidence, I think has been shaken in the Constitution and the system, which arguably to some people has been rigged and all that. Query from your point of view, how is the system doing? How is the Constitution doing in your life on the court? How do you feel the country you know, is in the social compact, if you will, of the relationship of the citizens and the Constitution?
Well, the one thing to be concerned about is that public confidence in government institutions or any institutions, according to public opinion surveys, is substantially down. And I think those surveys are probably accurate. All branches of government, if asked, do you have a generally favorable or unfavorable reaction to Supreme Court, judiciary, Congress, President, everything's down. And outside of government, the press, companies, labor unions, not many people are registering a higher score than they used to. Analysts talk about this being a change election, or the classic question the Gallup poll's been asking since like the 30s, is the country on the right track? The response, no, is huge, and that's troublesome and ought to be of concern to everybody. Now, it's not unique in the country's history. There have been times when there was, we had a civil war once and people died, so we're well short of that, but it's something we ought to be mindful of. And if we can try to figure out what it is that is causing the public, or a substantial part of it, to lose confidence in public institutions, we need to address it. Doesn't affect my day-to-day job at all, doesn't affect the court's decisions, but the reality is that the court and all governmental institutions depend upon public support. This is not a nation of force. We're not trying to compel people. It's not a military dictatorship. If people don't voluntarily comply, then our institutions don't work the way they're supposed to work. Mm-hmm. So we need to try to figure out why it is people are dissatisfied and what it is we can do to restore confidence.
Mm. I hope you'll come back when you go senior, after you go senior status, and we can discuss this and many issues forward.
I hope not to wait until the next time the Cubs win the World Series.